for how intellectual property system, although it's structured broadly as intellectual property, you have various categories like patents, copyright, trademarks, and each of them have their own nuances when it comes to structuring the property rights. For example, you would have broader fair use provisions in copyright, where you will not have such things in patent law, barring the research exemption or experimental use or even exhaustion, right? And you would also require higher standards of liability. For example, for copyright, you require a strict proof of copying, while in patents you would not require them. In trademarks, definitely the underlying paradigm for property, granting them property status, is not that we want to ensure that people are incentivized to create new marks, but the idea is that society benefits from the information asymmetries that are prevalent in the market, so that consumers get to know the source of the goods. And that's how consumer protection is one of the fundamental objectives of the property status we grant for trademarks. But all of these systems in themselves are not, although not self-contained, but they have their own nuances. And in this panel, we are trying to explore some of these nuances. And I would first like to call upon Professor Dr. Ramakrishna to speak.
Distinguished fellow panelists, Dr. Yogesh, the moderator, and my dear friends. The invitation by Mr. Yogesh Pai initially was to present a study that we had done on the determination of prima facie case while granting injunctions. But the theme of the panel is a little broader than that particular thing, and therefore I will just very, very briefly touch upon that particular study and then move on to the core issues that he has highlighted. It was based basically on the prima facie case, and we examined cases from 2006 to 2016, and we found that there is lack of a standard for determination of prima facie case. And is it required at all is what we explored, and we thought that there is a need for creation of a standard for determination of prima facie case. That's very briefly about what we did. And the property perspective that you find in the IP, especially the patent system, Supreme Court has clearly indicated that this could be a property, and this was clearly indicated in 2011 in KT Plantation versus State of Karnataka, where it said expression property in Article 300A, confined not to land alone, it includes intangibles like copyright and other IP, and embraces every possible interest recognized by the law. Well, the major problem that comes with this relief or the remedies that you have is, are these remedies related to the substantive rights that have been created? And do they have any specific relationship between the two? And in this particular context, while exploring the scholarship in this area, I found that one particular extreme says, yes, there is something called as right to exclude, which flows from the property system. And there are circumstances where remedies have been granted without any relation or little or no relation to the right to exclude, right, or the property issue. So these are the two extremes that we find. If you just look at the first part of it, when you say right to exclude, the flow from that particular thing would be the consequentialist. It says there's a presumptive consequence that person should get an injunction. Although the Supreme Court of US in eBay case has reversed that particular opinion of the Federal Circuit. They're saying that no, that cannot happen. Right? But scholars have indicated, like Lemley and others have indicated, that right to exclude is the essence of true property right. And the flow from that would be to exclude others. Therefore, injunction should be or ought to be granted. When you look at the second part, there's little or no relation aspect, they would say that there is no relationship between the property on the one hand and the remedy on the other hand. Creation of right is distinct from the remedies. Therefore, you're entitled for remedies in a different context altogether. There are attempts made by quite a few scholars who relate private law property rights and remedies. And they started exploring this particular one through the conceptual philosophy that they have come up with. Right? And there are different approaches that have been taken. And these different approaches looked at from private law perspective, they say that the first view, the right to exclude view, or the little or row relation view, both right apply not in the broader context but in a very, very limited context. This is the approach that, these particular philosophers have taken. And therefore they say it becomes inaccurate if you apply it outside that particular context. Therefore, either of these cannot be applied in this particular context, is what they say. And what determines the remedial right structure in most of the jurisdictions, it is the statutes, the law, the copyright law or the patent law, right, which determines the remedies. But then what happens when the courts start exploring and courts start implementing that particular provision of the law? That is when the courts are redirected again to the discretion, and the discretion here would be exercised in a manner where they are going to bring back that particular property or non-property elements into the whole debate. So which means it ultimately gets related to the property element in the IP. And for this, right, you find that the remedies here, right, the decisions that are being taken in case of remedy, they are, this is the larger opinion, we say they are neither free from application of the property rules, at the same time, they are not totally determined by the property rules. So some way between these two. And the property law channel inquiry is being done at three stages. Right? One is resource a property, on which perhaps my panelists would throw more light, whether it's creation is property, resource is property or not. And once you do that, then the question comes up, what type of property strategy are you going to apply in that particular context? Once the property strategy is also selected, which are different strategies, then the question comes up, are there factors which are could be looked into, which are going to put limitations on the application of this particular property, which means are you going to specific facts and then modify this particular property strategy when you actually apply it? And the property right, on which my panelists are going to speak on freedom, etc., etc., it protects freedoms. And there are three dimensions from which you're going to look at this property as such. Right to control, right to use, and dispose of. Right? The control, use, and disposal is what you're going to be looking at, which means when you are seeking remedy, saying that there is an infringement, there's a trespass on your property rights, are you clearly indicating here that the other person, the non-holder of the IP, is expected to utilize your resource after obtaining your consent, and are you going to determine the way in which he's going to utilize that? Or are there circumstances where the other party can say, the non-holder can say, well, I can use this particular resource even without your consent, right? Is it based on the what is called as the right of disposition? If it's based on right of disposition, then the consequences are many. Are you looking at the whole debate from the open texture format? And what happens if it's looked at from the open texture format? See, both the extremes you'll be looking at here. And then this particular consequence, when you say IP holder's right of disposition is protected, right? How? Through an injunction. And then therefore, does it mandate injunction? Is it merely consequential in nature? But if you look at the whole development, you find that even this particular conclusion is always rebuttable. It cannot be right as it is. What are those circumstances that we examine? And your hardships could be there, equitable consideration could be there, and so many exceptions, etc., etc., they're all there, where you can definitely rebut this particular conclusion. Fine. The one of the focus that I would look at is, there are arguments which have been brought in here, stating that being a non-rivalrous, which becomes part of public good, and because it's non-excludable, perhaps you should not apply in stricto senso the property approach to the intellectual property rights. That's one particular position being taken. And similarly, there are also concerns which have been expressed saying that, fine, you have control, right? The control here always reduces the social welfare. Or does it reduce social welfare? We keep debating on the deadweight loss consumers. And similarly, we also find that it inhibits use for further research. Well, can injunctions, right, be presumed in patent? The whole jurisprudence that is developed in India, especially in the context of, I just refer to one particular aspect, in the context of Delhi High Court decisions, numerous. One such is Roche versus CIIPC itself, which could be taken, where the argument that was presented by the parties for a presumptive conclusion that on production of the patent certificate, on production of the right claim for patent, the natural flow is that you should be entitled for an injunctive relief so that the other party would be prevented from utilizing his resource, the patent as such. But this is subject to so many limitations, etc. As you find, right, the absence of presumption point, the presence of various levels of scrutiny, the exclusions that have been present here, all these factors may have to be factored in. And the courts have clearly said, no, this particular argument cannot be taken up, despite the fact that there are multiple challenges available. Right? At the same time, the courts have also stated, fine, can you by just producing this, can you shift the burden onto the defendant to show that there is no such situation of prima facie? And this also the courts have clearly indicated, especially in Roche case, they said, no, you can't impose that particular burden, because at the initial stage of interlocutory applications, what is to be shown by the defendant is merely the vulnerability and not the invalidity. Right? If vulnerability is shown, perhaps there should be enough at this particular stage, and therefore imposing a heavier burden would be, right, totally against the very notions of justice here. This is what they said, and ultimately the court clearly indicated no ipso facto entitlement for injunction. So which means the proper property concept from which, if you logically do, which flows the mandating of injunction is not the present jurisprudence, is not the present law. At least in US, India also, it's not the approach. Right? Which means you are not getting injunction easily the moment you say that you have a patent right. That's not. There are so many factors weighed for, against, and then ultimately has been determined. But ultimately, does it take us back to the property element? Does it take us back to the substantive rights which are in the form of the property rights? That's a question that perhaps is to be discussed and debated. Thank you very much, panelists. Thank you very much.
Adam Plough.
Well, thanks very much to National Law University, to CIIPC and CPIP, and my friend Professor Yogesh Pai for the invitation. This question, whether intellectual property is property, is currently of interest in the United States because our presidential administration, the Trump administration, filed a brief in a case pending before the Supreme Court of the United States, known as Oil States Energy versus Greens Energy, arguing that, in fact, patents are not property, which must be adjudicated by a court, but instead are public rights, the validity of which could be determined by an administrative agency. Now, the key move in the administration's brief was to say that patent monopolies did not exist at common law, and therefore patents are only those exist by statute, and therefore quintessential public rights, as the administration argued. Now, this argument only works if patents are essentially or exclusively government-conferred monopolies, and the administration didn't actually make that argument. In fact, it cited, ironically, in support, a 1923 Supreme Court decision describing the common law rights to make, use, and sell an invention, authority which complicates the administration's argument considerably. A better and more eloquent statement of the American tradition, I would argue, comes from Abraham Lincoln in his famous address, The Lecture on Discoveries and Inventions. where he praised the patent laws not for creating property in innovation, but rather for securing it. Patent laws, Lincoln argued, brought about the last great advance in human creativity by securing to inventors what was already a valuable right, but wanted security, namely the right to use and make one's invention. The genius of the Patent Act, Lincoln famously argued, added the fuel of fire, the fuel of interest to the fire of genius in the discovery and production of new and useful things. Now, commenting on Lincoln's now famous metaphor, the late Michael Novak observed that Lincoln saw in the patent laws an unprecedented blessing, for the security that such laws added to pre-political property rights ignited human energies in productive directions. By contrast, Novak wrote, a regime that does not secure natural rights depresses human energy. Natural rights are not mere puffs of air, Novak argued. They formalize capacities for action that in some societies lie dormant, and in others are fueled into ignition. The United States, Lincoln believed, lit a fire to the practical genius of its people, among the high-born and low-born alike. And I would argue in a world of 7 billion people and counting, with scarce natural resources and seething human energy, there's something to this innovation. Now, property in patents does this work because patents are not essentially tools to thwart cooperation. They're instead property rights. And property rights are ways of securing zones of liberty and power, freedom and ability to perform creative acts of private ordering, which enhance the welfare of everyone. The right to exclude often receives the most attention, but that's only because it does all of the famous and infamous conflict-ridden work of securing the zone. But it's the liberties and the powers at the core of property, which constitute the essence of what property is, and the exercise of those liberties and powers to bring about new goods, new states of order and value in the world is in fact the point of property. Just so with patents. The American justification for patents to promote the progress of science and the useful arts is not a grudging concession to monopoly privileges. Rather, the American founders had a positive vision for patents as a foundational predicate for all of the coordination that needs to happen to bring innovations to market: investment, employment, disclosure, licensing, conveyance, and so forth. Now, our Supreme Court has explained the juridical architecture of a patent on several of occasions. It says said that a patent does not create the right to practice the invention. That right precedes the patent, which only renders it a right of exclusive use. So, for example, in United States American Bell Telephone Company case, the court compared invention patents with land patents. They're both property, the court observed, but in the land patent, the grant comes from the government. Quote, on the other hand, the patent for an invention is not a conveyance of something which the government owns. It does not convey that which, but for the conveyance, the government could use and dispose of it as sees fit, and to which no one save the government has any right or title. But for the patent, the thing patented is open to the use of anyone. After the issuance of the patent, the right to use becomes enclosed within, surrounded and secured by the right to exclude, or more precisely, rights to exclude anyone and everyone who would otherwise practice the invention. So the patent itself then stands guard around the property in the middle, the liberty to use the invention, which is unaltered except for the security added to it. This is vividly illustrated where patents are acquired and maintained for defensive purposes, where the patentee's reason is to prevent others from meddling in his own productive venture. The value of the patent is not for offensive purposes, pursuing infringement actions, but rather to prevent being sued as one carries on one's business. Patents are valuable to these owners because of the core of what the property is, the liberties of use and immunities for using. Properties also serve other non-offensive purposes. They signal to potential investors that a patentee has done his homework. He knows the prior art. A large portfolio of patents can signal to potential employees and partners that this is a creative venture. And of course, as we've heard in the first panel, patents facilitate disclosure, which facilitates licensing, which facilitates production and innovation. So I would argue the Trump administration's argument in oil states misses what patents most centrally are, which is the liberty to make beneficial use of inventions and immunity for doing so. This is even clearer, I think, in the case of trademarks. The trademark is derivative from and appurtenant to the goodwill of the business, a property. And so it's very easy to think of the trademark in property terms. You can think of it as an easement. It's a right which is appurtenant to the estate from which it is derived and which it serves. So viewed in this way, the right to exclude is a security for property, that is, for liberties and powers to use and to make. And the basis of the remedies for infringement, then, is grounded fundamentally in this power to do good in the world for the common good. This makes a patent something like a writ at common law. The writs were not all created by positive statutes, but rather grew up out of common law practice, experience, in order to vindicate pre-existing rights and to remediate wrongs, that is, the deprivation of rights. The writs certainly shaped the law, but they were shaped by demand for redress for wrongs, which were determined by reference to private rights. And in the common law tradition, these are settled and specified prior to and independent of their declaration in court or parliament. Rights and wrongs arise primarily from immemorial custom, acts of private ordering, such as gift and devise, and from natural law. And so judicial decisions and statutes start by declaring what the rights are, and then direct remedies for remediation of their deprivation. Statutes either codify the rights and wrongs, or provide some remedy where it didn't exist before. And so the boundaries of rights and wrongs, as the common law jurists call them, are ascertained, not created, by courts in actions for redress of wrongs, and by legislatures in statutes. Similarly, the advent of patents required positive law and state action, but those laws and that action presupposed that people were already engaged in productive activities in the exercise of their natural rights, but needed incentivization to be open and cooperative. It is precisely because the core of the patent is liberty and power to make productive use for the common good that the right to exclude must be enforced robustly in both law and equity. So the Supreme Court in the Continental Paper Bag case expressed the classical view that a trespass upon exclusion right of a patent is by itself actionable injury, which justifies equitable relief, an injunction. Quote, from the character of the right of the patentee, we may judge of his remedies. It hardly needs to be pointed out that the right can only retain its attribute of exclusiveness by a prevention of its violation. Now, as the professor alluded to a moment ago, the more recent decision in eBay versus Merck Exchange illustrates that the court does not say that any violation of any patent right justifies equitable relief. Rather, violation of the exclusion right raises a presumption that the patentee is entitled to an injunction. And the presumption is generally conclusive in cases of intentional infringement. The justices in eBay took pains to emphasize that they did not intend to displace traditional equitable maxims in favor of the right to exclude and against intentional infringement of it. And the reason is very simple. As Chief Justice Roberts observed, injunctive relief is appropriate to protect property rights, the very infringement of which constitutes an actionable harm. But of course, the reason for this is that when they work as property rights, patents are facilitating all these cooperative exercises of property. That is, enhancing the general welfare, promoting the common good, by securing the powers and liberties of innovators, investors, licensees, and all of their various collaborators to work together. Nothing less than the common good is at stake, and that is why injunctive relief is presumptively allowed in these cases.
Good afternoon. It's good to be back here. As we are discussing the intricacies of the property doctrine and how it manifests on intellectual property right, I just want to present a brief introduction, if I can call that, on the intangibility aspect that is inherent in intellectual property right and how that bears on how we understand rights and how we can have appropriate remedies based on our understanding of this intangibility aspect. I would also like to do something ambitious in the process, because I would like to answer a question that was not raised in the earlier session. I say it was not raised because it was floating all over the place, begging to be answered. So I just pick and I'll try to answer that, or probably pitch my talk to ensure that we will see some light at the end of the tunnel. The question was, why is it that different types of infringement, intellectual property, or to phrase it in my own words, why is it that there is no criminal liability on infringement? That's a broad statement. When in this country, there can be criminal liability on trademark infringement and copyright infringement, but not for patent infringement. Now, why is that distinction there? I'll try to put some thoughts in front of you so that we will all be richer in the things that we have commonly confounded with. When it comes to intangible property, apart from looking at the rights that that we have and the remedies, what is seminal for us to also look at is the fact that there is the creation of the intellectual property or the intangible property, which itself brings it to life. And this is not, many a times property is compared with real property, that is land. In fact, in the US, they had land patents, so it was easy. You will see the earlier Supreme Court judgments actually saying this, that land patents, the patents for inventions are just like the patents for land. So you already had an analogy. But we know that property in land cannot be created, it can only be colonized. So the exceptions to how creation of intangible things happen has a bearing on how we understand these rights. Now let's take patents as the example, because in terms of intangibility, nothing manifests the intangible part as well as patents do in intellectual property rights. For something to be patentable, you have to go through the tests of patentability. You have to demonstrate that in writing that there is novelty, inventive step, and utility. So that has to be demonstrated in writing. So you come up with your invention in your lab, but to get a patent, you need to demonstrate these things in writing. So the physical aspect of the invention now gets textualized. So you have to capture the entire thing in text and you have to present it to the patent office. So the patentability criteria itself is a task the patentee has to get over. Then there are exceptions to patent. What can be patented, what cannot be patented, the patent eligibility criteria. And apart from these two things, the creation of the right also vests with the patentee or the patent applicant the right or the responsibility to make a disclosure. Now, this is true for patents. You need to make a disclosure. And the disclosure has broadly two elements which the applicant has to satisfy. One element is what we call the teaching element. What you disclose has to teach the world. And in the US and in this country, you have three elements of that. You need to have a written description. You need to have an enabling disclosure. And you need to have the best mode or the best method, as we call it here. Now, all these factors brings in a teaching element to the right that you have, the right you will eventually have. So, and these factors are articulated in what we call a patent specification. So again, the invention happens somewhere in a lab or in a garage, wherever that is. But to get this right, you need to now demonstrate in writing that you have enabled a person skilled in the art on how to do it, the teaching element. The written description has to be clear and succinct. It should not be ambiguous. It should be very clear. And the fact that you have described the best mode. Historically, this was not the case. In the early days of patent, we didn't have these requirements. There was just the broad disclosure requirement. It was sometime in the 19th century, the US courts actually started saying, certain things are not clear, we need more clarity. The claim itself as a statutory requirement came only in the 19th century. So you had broad disclosures made by the inventors. The inventors never thought about claiming something initially. It was a pressure from the courts and later on followed by legislative amendments that we had this thing of a claim appearing in the, it's the same in the United Kingdom as well. The claims came later when they were rights with regard, people were enforcing rights with regard to who owned what. the requirement of claims came in. And claims also perform another function, which is the notice function. So you have in intangible, especially in patent, you have the your patent specification needs to satisfy the teaching function and the notice function. The notice function is something which we all understand that property has. The land has a notice function. All the personal property that we hold has some kind of a notice function. The borders are clearly ascertainable. But the teaching function is unique for patents. Now, why is it relevant? Why is the teaching function relevant? Can we not just ignore the teaching function and say that this is plain, simple, or property simpliciter? Why can't we just enforce this as property? The reason being, the teaching function can come up when you want to enforce your rights. The teaching function can also come up before this right even crystallizes, because at the patent office, if you don't demonstrate this teaching function, then you may not be even granted a patent. When the patent is being infringed and when there is an infringement action, you can raise the non-satisfaction of the teaching function, the enabling disclosure, the best method, best mode or the best method, and the written description. You can, in India we call it insufficiency. You can raise these grounds to say that, hey, I could be infringing, you may have an injunction, but I'm questioning the validity of this patent. To this, some scholars, economists have called this the intellectual property right, more specifically patent rights, as probabilistic rights. Rights that can exist, but you know, they are created, they exist for 20 years, then they suddenly disappear one fine day, or if it's revoked, they can again disappear. So they call it improbabilistic right. Now, I have this thesis of that this could be a case of a disappearing property. And I call it disappearing property for at least 5 reasons. One, when a patent is revoked, the patent becomes ab initio void. It's hard to think of an analogy in the real world. Ab initio void, meaning which if you are infringing, there's a claim for damages, the infringement part or an injunction has to go because the property is now ab initio void. It is as though it was never created. So revocation has a consequence of the property being ab initio void. Whereas if you surrender your patent, and in India we have a provision where you can voluntarily surrender the patent becomes void only from the point of surrender. So whatever you did before that is not questioned. And ab initio void can have some drastic consequences, because if somebody ended up claiming money from you, enforcing their patents, you now have a claim back, you have a right to claim that money back. So ab initio void is not something which we normally attribute to normal property. Second, presumption of validity. Now, in this country, we don't have, at least there is largely, scholars believe that there is no presumption of validity as the patents are granted. In US as well, and the scholars are here with us, after the American Invents Act, there has been a question mark on that. Thirdly, patents can cease to have effect. Now, your property can suddenly become invalid just by an inaction from your end. If you fail to pay the renewal fees regularly, the patents can cease to have effect. Meaning which, if you fail to pay the renewal fees for a year in this country, if you file an infringement case, whatever infringement action that happened during the term when you did not renew your patent, you cannot have an enforcement action at all. So again, your right can cease in parts based on your inaction. Fourthly, and this is a point which we already mentioned, upon expiry, private property becomes public property. That is, upon expiry by revocation or by end of the term. And fifthly, this is unique for patents, what could be property in another country if you're not registered it here is not property here. So US patents, if you don't follow it up with Indian patents, you simply cannot enforce them. Now, what does this tell us about criminal liability, which some forms of intellectual property rights seems to have? Trademark has criminal action, infringement is criminal, has a criminal consequences, same with copyright. Now, when it comes to patents, historically there has been issues in crystallizing the right, and there have been requirements in the way in which patents are evolved, which requires you to disclose to the world at large what you have done, and the patents can be questioned at any point during its life and even after its life. I had this good fortune to examine a patentee in an infringement suit, cross-examined him after the patent had expired. The context was there was a claim on damages against my client. So we had to flog the dead horse. So the patent had expired. Because there was a claim on damages, we had to go ahead with the suit just to see that whether the damages could be whether my client will be liable for it. So this just brings one aspect of intangibles that we need to bear in mind, that intangibles, when they are created, there is an element which is normally not a requisite for tangible property. So with that, I'll just conclude my speech. I'll be open for any further discussion on this point. Thank you.
Ashutosh.
Thank you, Yogesh. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to part of this panel. And thank you all three panelists for highlighting and discussing very interesting points. I'm a litigator, so I'm actually not trained to summarize what others have discussed. I'm trained to rebut the points what raised by the other people. But however, I have few comments. I won't rebut or hear anything, but I have few comments and points discussed by fellow panelists. Starting with Dr. Ramakrishna, he discussed the aspect of injunctive relief and whether injunctive relief or right to exclude can be presumed as a consequence of any enforcement of patent right. And he highlighted the Roche versus Cipla case. The one thing which I want to clarify or to comment on his presentation is this, that there is a distinction between interim injunction and permanent injunction. So the courts have discretion, wide discretion, while at the stage of granting of interim injunctions. So they can withhold injunctions if they see that they apply the all three-factor test and they see that the interest is tilted in favor of defendant. However, when it comes to permanent injunction, as the statute which has been framed in India, the statutory scheme suggests that the court have a very less discretion in withholding a permanent injunction. So for instance, Section 108, which is a relief for infringement of patents, it's talk about that there are only two kind of relief which a court can grant. It's one injunction, another is damages or loss of account of profit. And injunction is a mandatory relief subject to certain terms. Historically, there was one section under our Patents Act in which the court had discretion to withhold that injunction. That was Section 112, which was repealed after 2002 amendment. So the statutory scheme suggests that that discretion to grant or not to grant injunction at the stage when you're deciding the suit finally has been taken away from the courts. However, there is a case, as Dr. Ramakrishna mentioned, Roche versus Cipla, where the court exercises discretion and said that as an exception, although there is infringement of patent, we are not granting injunction because the patent is about to expire. But that is not something which is a per se rule that in all patent infringement case, the court can deny injunction even after holding infringement. As per the statutory scheme, it's very clear that once injunction is, once infringement is upheld in favor of a patentee, the court will grant injunction. Coming to Professor McLeod's presentation, he discussed how the right to exclude is intertwined with the right to use, giving example of US Supreme Court decision in 1923. It's very interesting, and he said that this right to exclusion actually create a secure zone around your patented invention, which facilitate the commercialization of your invention and which gives liberty to a patentee to commercially exploit, to exchange, or to do some kind of a productive use of its invention, which is very, I fully agree with Professor McLeod's analysis. And I personally believe that if there is no right to exclude, then there is no value to a patent. The moment a patentee create an invention, that scientific knowledge is in public domain. The moment you file your application and you disclose it to the public, everyone possesses that knowledge. It's only patentee right to exclude which prevents all other people from not using that scientific knowledge for their benefit. And because of this right to exclusion, a patentee for a limited period of time can commercially exploit his invention, his or her invention. So definitely it's a right to exclude which confers a value on a patent on invention. And thirdly, Professor Firoz's presentation, where he interestingly highlighted the point of how patent rights as a property is a very uncertain property. It can be invalidated at any stage. And it's very interesting because you invent something, you file a patent application, you get a patent, and you feel that you have now a property right with you, something very valuable with you, and you can start commercializing your property right. However, suppose after 10 years or 20 years, your patent is invalidated. Now, there is a jurisprudence which is evolving, especially in UK. There was a case in 2013 where the court said that a patentee who sued someone, got an injunction against a party, and later on, after a few years, that patent was invalidated. The party who was injuncted at that time has a right to file a suit for recovery. Now, the thing which was in your hand and you were freely commercializing and happily suing other people and thinking as your property, as your asset, has converted into a liability. That other, all those people to whom you sued can now ask for recovery of their money or their loss because of your suit, if your patent is invalidated, even if on an application by a third party. So that's something which is very interesting, what Professor Firoz has highlighted. And with this, I think I have nothing more to say. Thank you. Yeah, Ishan?
Hi, am I audible? Yeah. Thanks, Yudhish. So I want to talk about two things today. One, I want to explore a theoretical issue which has been flagged by almost all the speakers on the podium today, which is to do with the kinds of limits that we draw around intellectual property using the language of property itself. And the other, I want to revisit the question that Yogesh himself put about the right to exclusion, as far as we understand it, relative to intellectual property, and how far do remedies in intellectual property map onto that right of exclusion. Okay, but before that, let's have a look at a couple of the presentations that came before me. I was deeply interested, especially by Firoz's analysis on the manner in which your intangible parts of property that are sort of recognized via patents, etc., rely not so much on the form in which we understand them today, which is in the form of written claims, but are at their core or at their very soul, they're about things that are scientifically provable, that are verifiable, that are capturable. And I think that's a deeply important point, because what we have now is a system that enables us almost artificially to knock out the validity of those very sort of those very rights, those very, very deeply property oriented rights, on the basis of things that were created on top of that. So what I will refer to this going forward is as a property sort of substructure, and then the IP stuff that's come on top of it. So if you were to look back to, for example, the bit that you described about insufficiency and things of that nature, those are all things that, those are contrivances that patent law has created on top of what the essential property right is. And now we're at a point where that can actually become a reason to invalidate a patent in itself and sort of destroy the core of the right, which I find deeply, deeply interesting. I think there's also a reason to perhaps suggest that that's completely artificial, because there is no actual basis for it apart from the fact that we have no other way of understanding it apart from sort of picking those points apart. And I think that's really where that discussion about disappearing property and things of that nature sort of fits in. I was also really interested by what Adam said on two grounds. One, I think that that discussion that you did regarding the U.S. administration brief in the Green Energy case, I think it reveals not just this really sort of irascible relationship with property that IP lawyers continue to have to this day, but I think it's also injecting a lot of sort of relevance and a lot of context into the kinds of difficulties that we have in terms of understanding again, that where that property's substructure fits into IP. But just to revisit what you said about that right to exclude, which I think you reasoned tends to do a lot of the heavy lifting as far as patents are concerned, even though there is a bit of a soul to the positive sort of cooperative and sort of coordination based value that property provides, especially in the context of patents. I think it's possibly easier to imagine it like a castle with a moat around it, where the right of exclusion forms the moat. And then sort of the positive core is the patent right that you're looking to protect. I think it's an analogy that is even deeper with trademarks, because there is something even stronger to sort of hold on to. Whereas, as Dr. Ramakrishna indicated, there's a lot of the Indian patent law which you could probably argue is the reverse, which is that at its very core, what we understand as the content of what's Section 48 under the Indian Patents Act is arguably normatively empty. There's nothing inside it. It's just a right to exclude other people from doing exactly what, in an ideal world, you should be doing. But that's also a good hook to sort of flag a couple of things that I wanted to talk about. I do believe that there has been a broad agreement from what I've heard of the previous panel as well as this one, that you can understand the right to property as sort of drawing limits around IP protection generally. But what that does is, if I were to go back to language that's slightly more familiar to Indian audiences, I think at its very core, we're talking about creating a right, title, or interest of some description in property that just in this event happens to be intellectual property. And if you were to go back and revisit like Indian statutes, you'd find that there is a vast amount of correlation and language that relates to joint ownership and assignments and transmissions and mutations under trademark law. A lot of our patent law, for example, is constructed in large parts around very traditionally sort of old property concepts. So we have mortgages and we have licenses, and you can create like all sorts of part rights in that property. So there is a very deep sort of property substructure that's built into the very end sort of foundations of Indian IP. But I think what's also happening as a consequence of Indian IP specializing so much, especially over the last, say, 10, 15 years like it has, is that these separate areas have sort of ended up growing in silos. So we don't really have any kind of coherence, any kind of correlation between how these concepts attach with regard to, say, trademark law versus with regard to patent law. You can see this in this very panel, right? I mean, you can see people talk about areas of expertise and then also try and make those kinds of correlations to trademarks where maybe they don't exactly fit. I think that's fascinating, but it's also concerning for me at least at one of two levels. I think the first way of sort of interpreting the difficulty that we have is that you can look at perhaps in the future attempting to reconcile the different types of property substructure type protections that you offer across types of IP. So you can say, okay, fine, if we understand a license or an assignment or a particular type of ownership structure in a particular way, that's exactly the same way you should attempt to interpret it under trademark law, under patents law, under copyright law, and so on and so forth. The other way of linking it is slightly more vertical, right? Is to say that because these ideas come from property and they're based on a property substructure, you should look at that substructure in connection with the property basis that it has. So if you connect it, if you connect the trademark part of it with, say, the right of assignment or the right to relieve a charge or to charge interest or to license it out or things of that nature, then that's the relationship that you should try and fortify. Similarly with patents, you could, because your statute, for example, recognizes your ability to license it in a wide variety of ways, or it recognizes your ability to take out a mortgage or treat it as basically treat it as physical property, then that is the relationship that you should be looking to sort of synchronize. So I think that there's definitely sort of, to use the, go back to that castle and moat analogy, I think you can create a couple of other moats around it, including one which would be just a property moat, right? So you then have to sort of mix the waters in, or whatever terrible analogy applies in this specific circumstance. What I'll conclude by doing is just pointing out on this right of exclusion. I think we suffer from an intellectual property system in India in particular, where we don't make distinctions about the degree to which our rights are enforced. And I think what it does in a deeply troubling kind of way is that you end up offering offering claimants in particular, you end up offering them an inch and they end up taking a mile. So you have situations where injunctive relief, which was intended to perhaps apply to a very limited or very specific kind of iteration of an intellectual property right, ends up shutting down entire businesses, right? So you have this definitely apply with trademark law, you have this apply with the website URL controversy that we've had with copyrights, we've had this happen across classes of protection with patents and things of that nature. And I think there's it's definitely worth considering whether you can sort of inject some proportionality into it, not just by drawing limits around those rights in a property kind of sense, but perhaps using sort of slightly more practical tools to draw limits around what we understand to be injunction law in general. That's a discussion that again will sort of raise deeper questions about how much you want to interfere with the property substructure, how much you want to interfere with just the sort of pure equity type relationship that IP law enjoys with reliefs of that nature. I think I'll close with that. I have a couple of other things to say, but I'm sure we can work those into conversation. Thanks.
Maybe the speakers can take a minute to and discuss and reply to each other. Maybe one minute each.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The alternative views that have been expressed to the right to exclude, which has a property element. Right, is looking at this particular right as a correlative of duty of the non-owners. Right? If you look at it as duty of the non-owners, then it goes back and says it's an issue of what is called as the inviolability. Right? Inviolability of right by resource is how you're going to look at it. And the moment you begin this particular logic, then it will have a functional feature, plus also it will not be a consequential, it will be non-consequential in that particular context. This is one particular alternative that generally is suggested, right, especially after the decision of the US. Shutosh Kumar has clearly pointed as how it differs, right, depending on whether it's temporary injunction prohibition or the permanent injunction. And even the extent of discretion to be given at interlocutory, that is also a matter of concern for the right holders. The simple reason that once an injunction is granted, and we have seen situations where the next stage of the hearing for the trial, right, sometimes is unreasonably delayed also, and the impact of that particular thing on the person who might be rightfully using it, or might be following an exception, or might not be infringing upon the patent, etc. So those consequences also have to be kept in mind. And therefore, we thought that if you can have some weighted or graded weightage to be given before you decide that there's a prima facie case. What we have seen in all these judgments of the court, high courts, which we examined, we found nearly 60% of the cases, injunctions, interpretations have been granted. But then, in 69% of the cases, the injunctions were granted, permanent injunction was not granted. Right, which means there's some defect, some stage, right? That's what we find. And therefore, we thought that there must be some factor to be built in before injunction, interpretation had to be granted. But that was the concern. And for this.
I really love the image of the castle and the boat, and I'm wondering if I use that, do I get to declare myself king?
If so, I'm gonna steal that going forward. So I think that there's obviously a conceptual divide, particularly between Professor Cater and myself. So I have an advantage somewhat perhaps in that I actually teach the first year tangible property course at my law school. And to my students, I always emphasize two things. One is that property is not the thing, it's the legal interest in the thing. And so you can't understand title, for example, if you're thinking about property in terms of things. And so Professor Cater says, for example, he can't, you know, it's hard to envision a situation where you could think of a property in land being after the fact, retrospectively declared invalid ab initio. But there's all sorts of examples of that. There's titles that are declared in quiet title actions after the fact. Adverse possession, where the adverse possessor's title relates back to the initial entry. There's defeasible estates, which are contrasted with vested private rights. So of course, if you're going to think of property as the thing itself, it's going to be hard to think of patents as property. But that's not what property is. Similarly, property is not merely the right to exclude. Now, as I said, right to exclude gets all the attention because that's where all the conflict is. But there are different property estates that you couldn't understand if you're thinking about property exclusively in terms of exclusion, like easements, choses in action, licenses in public accommodations. All of these are property rights which entail no right to exclude. And so similarly, if you're thinking of patent, if you're trying to think of property patents exclusively in terms of exclusion as property, then yeah, you're going to run into conceptual difficulties. But these aren't conceptual difficulties for property. So property has all sorts of different concepts and doctrines which can be brought to bear, and some of those concepts are going to play out differently for different resources. So intangible resources, a classic contrast is between riparian water rights and bailments. So in riparian water rights, you have a hybrid situation where those who, at least in the English system, the common law system, where those who are riparian to the water source have a right to exclude outsiders. But as between them, they all have rights of use in common. That's very different from a bailment, where I entrust my suit to the cleaner, and the cleaner has only the right to exclude, right? So two different resources, two different property concepts at work. And so if you understand property in this more plural, differentiated way, you can begin to see the senses in which patents and trademarks and copyrights are property and in which they're not. And then this plays out in equity, because the substantive right is supposed to be specified before you get to equity. The chancellor is supposed to have the power to enforce the substantive right, subject to the discretion to bring in all these other considerations, moral and utilitarian. And so you can see these exceptions. But the presumption starts with, we're supposed to vindicate the right. The right is supposed to be vindicated because the right is serving a real purpose.
Nothing in the form of any rebuttal to what the speakers and the commentators have said, but more so to apply this, whatever we have taken out of this session, to real situations. I mean, one of the things which Ashutosh had mentioned was we could have instances where we enforce these rights and later on in the future realize that these rights actually didn't exist for whatever reason. There was a determination and then you have this whole set of issues of how are we going to settle people and liabilities. Now, in I'm not sure about US, but in the United Kingdom you have cross undertaking and damages. Before an injunction is granted, the court will insist on a cross undertaking. Makes a lot of sense, because the nature of the property, we can discuss about the doctrinal implications, but how does it operate in the real world? In the real world, if you grant an injunction, and after 10 years, if you're going to remove it, you cannot set the rights back in place. It's a done deal. The 10 years is gone. There's no way you can compute the damages. You can have a claim on damages if there is a undertaking given, but still you are not going to get 10 years back to the person to, you know, exploit if there was a product there in the market. So how we tackle this is by looking at the future and saying that, yes, we know nothing about the future, how some courts involve in something called a mini trial. You know, you have the interim stage and they get to do a mini trial just to see how the rights are posed. Is there a valid challenge on the patent? And in this country, we have this tons of case laws which says that, you know, you could come to a preliminary determination on validity before even enforcing it. So the point is, the discourse of this kind should actually have an implication on how the courts are eventually going to treat this. So the safer thing, in my opinion, to do would be to understand that these rights have inherent difficulties in the way we understand them, and trial is a laborious process, and the eventual outcome of a trial is something which the court itself does not know. I mean, Professor Ramakrishna was mentioning in 69% of the cases where interim injunctions were granted were not followed up with permanent injunction. It's a classic case of we not knowing how these rights will eventually turn out. So the point is, we could come to an understanding on the doctrinal implications, but we should also have some kind of a real-world solution on how these rights are going to be implemented and enforced by the courts of law.
Am I audible? So from a point of view of a practitioner, I'll say that treating patent as a property right, I think it provides sufficient guidance to us to how to regulate this right. Because we have a rich jurisprudence available for regulating the tangible properties, either immovable or movable. So for example, in case of tangible properties, if there is any dispute between, for instance, landlord and tenant regarding the rent, the law which is there that says that they can apply to the controller for determination of fair rent, and during that period the tenant will deposit that amount with the controller, or the controller can release that amount to the landlord subject to some guarantee. Now the courts in India have started applying the same jurisprudence in the context of patent right as well. So we have now an alternative model of interim injunction, which is called interim arrangement model. And in a lot of cases, the court have said that, okay, defendant, there is an uncertainty whether you are infringing someone's patent right or not, and whether the patent is valid or not. However, just to balance the interest of both the sides, the court directs that during the pendency of trial, you deposit the royalty money in court or give it to the plaintiff subject to a counter bank guarantee. So this is the jurisprudence which court has adopted from the normal property laws and applied in the context of patent right. So that's why if we treat a patent as a property right, there is a sufficient guidance for us to how to regulate these rights and conduct of a patentee. Coming to the point which Professor Ramakrishnan mentioned about the non-grant of permanent injunction in most of the cases in comparison to interim injunction. I think the major cause is delay in adjudication of dispute. And most of the cases, for instance, I'm doing four cases in which patent has already expired, the matter is still pending. So the main reason for a non-grant of permanent injunction in a lot of cases is that the patent is already expired. The moment patent is expired, the relief on injunction becomes infructuous. So for instance, in India, we have total 6 final judgment after trial. Out of 6, I think only in 4 cases, the court held that there is infringement. Out of those 4 cases, only in 1 case, that's Roche versus SIPA, the court said that we are not granting injunction because the patent is about to expire.
That was because it's closer to
expiry date. But ultimately, the court has granted injunction, they upheld the infringement. It's only for because of expiry of the patent, they withhold the relief of the injunction. But in rest of the cases, the injunctions were granted. So almost 80% of final decided cases, the injunctions are being granted. I'm not sure, though. I haven't seen that any data to support that figure of 69%. But as far as I know, and there was a study, I think it was reported on some blog as well, CIIPC blog as well, that from 2005 to 2015, there were totally 5 final decided cases. There's one more from Kerala, which was decided in 2000.
Yeah.
And so there are total 6 cases which have been decided after post-trial.
Right.
And in those 6 cases, out of those 6 cases, in 4 cases, the court came to the conclusion that there is an infringement, and out of those 4, in 3, injunctions were granted.
Yeah, just to follow up on that, my guess is that that 69% is a little misleading in the sense that those aren't necessarily all cases that go to judgment. I think you need to measure those against cases that go to judgment, and I think as Ashutosh suggested, there may be instances where a formal finding of infringement may have been entered, except that something happened in the intervening period to make sure that finding never reached fruition. I have a couple of other points. One, to quickly put a bow on this this property rights thing between patent lawyers that's going on here. I think a fairly useful way to think about this may just be to say that there are certain manners in which property rights are enforced that are relative to the whole, and there are certain that are absolute to the whole. So when we speak about absolute to the whole, we think of ownership, we think of possession, we think of sort of possessive injunction, we think of mandatory injunction, things of that nature. Okay. When we think of relative to the whole, we talk about the examples that Adam was talking about, which is like bailment or taking interest on things or taking out loans or taking out whatever other kinds of creating charges, things like that. So I think that it's obviously going to be a struggle for us to imagine a type of IP relief that imposes onto an IP right in a specific circumstance, for example, in patent infringement, that still allows a relative to the whole kind of model to exist. Because in most cases, you're attempting to cut out the activity entirely. So I think that's probably where Thoreau's difficulty lies in terms of trying to understand, you know, is this patent infringement? Can it be patent infringement? Because you're always thinking in absolutes. You're always thinking in terms of complete invalidity. There is no such thing as the patent would be operating in half or something, right? I mean, there might be, but those are extremely extreme outliers. And the other thing I wanted to mention is something Ashutosh rightly pointed out as well, is that our security for cost model in India is effectively your cross undertaking in damages. I don't think of it as having any kind of procedural or doctrinal impact that is particularly different from the cross undertaking on damages. I think it's basically intended as this sort of economic fail-safe in the event that because you recognize that the patent infringement outcome itself is a little uncertain and you want to safeguard both sides' financial interest. Obviously, it leaves the question of what happens to the economic opportunity of exploiting the patent for that period of time, which is something that you can't obviously, in India, you can't even ballpark, honestly. But I do think that system is in place, and I do think that we're also moving towards a system where you're imposing costs to the basically cost to claimant in the event that applications opposing the claimant are unsuccessful. So I think that that's something that we're moving towards as well. That's a question of whatever winner justice, something like that. Obviously, there are slightly deeper justice type implications to it. But I do think that that's on the table in India. I don't think that's far fetched.
So before we move on to the there are a lot of things that can be discussed in the context of intellectual property and the property doctrine, primarily also in the way we have structured, for example, exhaustion regime. The exhaustion regime actually goes back to property principles. And that's why there's some sense in saying that intellectual property is property, because you wouldn't have those kind of exceptions that are carved out to the intellectual property regime without considering it as a property. So I would now open this panel to comments and maybe questions, maybe pointed questions, since we have very little time. So yeah, I can see a hand there. Yeah.
And then here. So my name is
a legal heir can also make a claim, right? With reference to filing of an application.
Why is it not in copyright and trademark?
Would be restricted till the validity of your IP right. So the moment the term of your IP right is over, your property is gone.
So that is my question. Why is that? So because the same.
You're saying why are rights not in perpetuity? Then
yeah.
That's the question.
Because
so, Adam or Feroz or anybody could like to take your question.
Yeah,
Feroz.
Intellectual property rights are rights that are conferred by the state. They are created by the statute. And there is a public element almost inherent in most of the rights, barring trademarks and trade secrets. The public element is that there is a benefit that the benefit that the public gets out of it. So you in patents, when you make a disclosure, you have to teach the public at large, and it becomes, after a point, it gets into the public domain. So this is, there's an incentive-based thing that, once you have an incentive for people to bring it out to the world, you can register it. There is a specific period of exclusivity granted, and after that, it is available for everybody to use. Going back to your question, the term in intellectual property is set, especially for patents and copyright, in a sense that after the point, the public can actually enjoy it. Whereas for trademarks, there's no such restriction. As long as you keep it alive, enforce it, and keep paying the fees, you can enjoy it in perpetuity. Inheritance is something, as my Ashutosh rightly put it, it can be inherited, provided it happens during the term of the intellectual property right.
Thank you.
There, of course, was a very robust debate on this exact question in the late 18th century in the English courts. And the Americans answered the question one way, the English answered the question a different way, and we're seeing some of that play out in this room today. You know, the Indian patent system, for example, to the extent that it's understood as descended from the English system, where a letter patent was issued as a result of the royal prerogative. And so it emanates entirely at the discretion of the king, and it has to be exercised on the king's terms. And so if the king requires you to exercise the patent, well then by golly, you have a duty to exercise the patent. That wasn't the American view. And Americans related to jurisprudence that was developing in copyright law in the English courts at the time, on this question whether copyrights are in fact personal to the author. There's some very good scholarship. Abraham Drasenauer, University of Toronto, makes the argument that the reason why the term in copyright is the lifetime of the author plus is because this is a right that is personal to the author in a way that's not the case necessarily with inventions. Furthermore, there's lots of intellectual property that is perpetual, right? So trade secrets, rights against unfair competition, a trademark which is appurtenant to the goodwill of the business is going to persist as long as the business does. So the idea that intellectual property writ large is just a conferral of monopoly privilege by the state, which is limited in term, it just doesn't capture what, you know, the whole corpus of the law. It plays out differently in different doctrines.
Just a few parts to whatever they have stated. He was referring to the first statute of monopolies, right, where the term was for 14 years. See, you just see the roots of this patent system. They said it should be for 14 years. Why should it be for 14 years? The logic that they gave here was a person, an apprentice. The apprentice acts for 7 years, you'll have to be an apprentice to get skills in the latest technology. If a person wants to get skills in the existing technology for 7 years, perhaps if it's a new technology, he requests the double the time, right? Give him 14 years so that he will learn the technology. And after that, people should be able to use that particular thing. So that's the basis of the whole debate that happened, right? And similarly, if you come to copyright also, you said it was not right for perpetuity. It was in 1842, if I recall, that an amendment was made to the UK Copyright Act, where they said it should be for the life of the author plus 7 years. Why did they do that? There was a stark instance of Wordsworth's descendants suffering because of his right focus on the literary work, and they did not have anything. And that is when they said the right descendants also should be taken care of.
Two generations should benefit.
Exactly. That is how it started off. Right? There's a logic behind that. And trademark, as you pointed out clearly, it's perpetual because that's going to have a life. That as long as consumers are able to identify the product.
Thanks.
I
just want to add that
fundamental principle which is there is that everyone is free to compete with each other. And free competition is a principle. IPR is an exception to that that principle. And all IP rights confer some kind of exclusivity or monopoly on its holder because of some underpinning rationale of public interest. So patent as an interest that it will incentivize innovation, it will facilitate disclosure of invention for the benefit of society. And the legislature presumes that the 20 years period, first of all, because it's an exception, it has to be a very limited period of exceptions. Because and otherwise, that public interest which a legislator want to achieve will be frustrated if you give such kind of a right for perpetuity. So the technological development of society won't take place if a patentee has a right over his or her invention for his lifetime. So that's why the IP rights are limited period rights. That's one of the reasons. Because of some public interest.
One.
Thank you for allowing me to ask a question and this very much thoughtful discussion. I'm Shekhar from Jawaharlal University, Center of Studies in Science Policy. I have just one, two things to ask. One thing is, you talked about disclosure, where disclosure is mean to teach one thing, and disclosure is mean to enhance the technology. But when we consider the present regime, particularly the software patents, the disclosure is nowhere enough to replicate the technology. So where the reliability of patent lies? Because the patents are not fulfilling the purpose they were made for. And second, in a country like India, developing nation like India, where after every 100 kilometer language changes, the accessibility of a patent document or technology is a big issue. So how can we impose the restriction on a person who cannot even access the knowledge or the technology? And it is not something which is his mistake, because it's naturally excluded from accessing the information. So how do you see this accessibility in terms of patent right?
I mentioned those words, probably it's on me. Okay. The teaching requirement crept in because of transfer of technology. If you go back in time, the British rulers were giving monopolies for people to come make soap, glassware from continental Europe, and they would say that if you bring in this, the teaching requirement initially was what you heard, the 14-year protection period. 14-year translates into training 2 apprentices. They actually said that, it's there, that you have to train 2 apprentices during the time of monopoly. And then they also made a condition that the apprentices had to be Englishmen. So you can't bring your own people from Italy and train them, it had to be people. So this was largely a way in which the technology transfer happened. And the protection was there for them to do that. So the disclosure requirement in software, I mean, we can have a different debate probably at a different time on whether patents for software can be done and to the extent to which it can be done. But this is something that the patent office has to look into. A disclosure standard is a requirement for the grant of a patent. So if the patent office feels that the disclosure is not doing the job, it can raise objections. And in India, you have multiple ways in which those things can be done. So the disclosure requirement is something that an applicant needs to satisfy to the satisfaction of the patent controller. Now coming back to the second part,
can I just intervene? I'm briefly I'm a bit concerned with this question. If you say that software disclosures cannot be replicated, then how is software infringement actually happening in the market?
They are basically the feature patent. They define the software can do this function, this device can do this function.
Correct. So the function gets replicated as in the form of infringement, right? Exactly, because there are, and we'll perhaps do that in the next session, wherein, a lot of knowledge that is not disclosed is part of secrecy. And secrecy is also a kind of intellectual asset that, firms try and see that it doesn't get misappropriated, right? So the function, and there are papers on the question of secrecy versus patents and, how much you disclose and what are the implications. But I think the broader question is, again, going back, the quid pro quo of the patent system is that it has to disclose. But an element, and this is also happened in the last session, that we need something more than that, so that the society has to benefit in terms of actually being able to work it out on ground. So how far do we actually structure the patent bargain from a doctrinal perspective? Because now what is happening is in large number of industries, especially in ICT, you have non-vertically integrated industries where they are just doing what is called as pure R&D and innovation and filing patents, or rather paper innovations, right? So in such a situation, how do we conceptualize the property right in terms of its broader contours? Because if you look into, and this is a normal market function, that market super specializes over a period of time, and as a consequence is today you have only companies that file patents and do lab R&D, because the commercialization and implementation is all left to those who are in the goods market.
and not in the innovation. Yeah, you want to take that in the, Piroz, you would like to continue and then, yeah.
The second part of that question, why is it that some of the patterns people are not, is it, it does not translate into knowledge for everyone? Patterns are documents which are addressed to a, technically, it's meant to be addressed to a person skilled in the art. So if you have a patent on biotechnology, though it is available in the patent database for you to read, it's not addressed to you. You need to have some background knowledge, what we call a, you need to have the domain skill for you to even understand it. Because I say this because tomorrow when the court interprets a patent, it's going to put itself in the shoes of a person skilled in the art, a skilled person. So you may say that it's technically available for all of us to read, but the amount of knowledge that gets transferred or that is through the, that gets transferred through the patent specification is meant to a skilled addressee. So that element has to be factored to say that I read this patent, I didn't understand that. That may not be the way to look at it, rather to get a person who is in the domain to read it. And it's because it's many a times they use definitions which are particular to the art. So in that sense, I would say that the requirement that all patents should be understood by everyone may not be a reasonable requirement to look for.
Yeah, and
question. So from a perspective internal to private law, this problem of the formal requirements of the specification just go away when you think about patents as a quid pro quo, because a quid pro quo is simply a contract. And a contract is just an exchange of property with formalities attached to it. The formalities in pure contract law, of course, are just consideration, meeting of the minds, and so forth. So the specification begins to look like the formal requirements of a contract. Well, then the reason why the public interest comes in to limit your property rights is because your contract partner in the quid pro quo is the public, right? So you can view this from an internal perspective of private law, and the whole thing hangs together. The reason why the public is interested in the way in which the patent gets implemented and the remedies for enforcement is because the public is actually your contracted partner with the patentee.
There's one last question. Because we started the session a bit late, so maybe we can take one more. Quickly.
My name is Dipesh Jain. I work at JICO Center at OP Chandra Global University. I have a quick comment and a question. The comment is taken away from Mr. Ghosh's discussion. So Mr. Ghosh mentioned that how getting an injunction in IP matters is actually very harmful for the companies and like many businesses have toppled. I would like to comment that even in case of pure immovable property, getting an injunction at the beginning stage is supposed to be a big win, and like the opposite party is actually the many big projects get stalled, and there are many implications in that case as well. The question is actually taking cue from Professor Adam mentioned about adverse possession doctrine. So I would like to know your comment on can we make an analogy on the limitation period on claiming an adverse possession and the recent debate on the working requirement of patents? So for example, in adverse possession, like at least under the Indian Limitation Act, there's a certain period in which you can actually claim for adverse possession and get your property back. But after which you cannot, you have to relinquish your property. So yeah, thank you.
As a property guy, I want to say yes, make an analogy to adverse possession by all means. I don't know enough about the Indian statute to know how well the analogy holds up. Just from a conceptual matter, there's no problem at all, right? I mean, in adverse possession is simply a way of acting as the true owner would. And we say after the fact, if you have acted as the true owner would act, and the true owner hasn't done anything to thwart you, then we're going to recognize your ownership. How that plays out under the particular statutory provision you're referencing, I just don't know about the statute. But there's no theoretical problem there.
Yeah. Professor Gandhi, the last question, and
I just want to clarify on this software.
To ask. The first part, that you must understand that in what the law says is that you have to disclose and make enabling disclosures, and you have to disclose the best mode for reproducing that particular invention. Right? That's what is required. That's what he said, and that's what the law is. Number two, that when you're looking at a patent and you're looking at the invention, please understand there's a big gap between the invention and a technology. Just by reading a patent and reading an invention, you may not be able to get the entire technology. That's the first part of it, okay? The second part of it is there could be a large number of patents together which develops a technology. So for that, a person skilled in the art has to understand the entire portfolio of patents to get that picture right. Third part, which is very important, is that when we write patents and we give the best mode, so you are expected to read the patent as a person skilled in the art and reproduce the invention which I'm claiming, right? Now when you come to me for the technology, there's a big gap, and that gap I keep in my pocket as an oil. When you come to me for the transfer of technology, please understand a patent is not a transfer of technology document. A transfer of technology document is a completely different cup of tea. Completely different cup of tea. In a patent document, you are only reproducing the invention. To give you an illustration, very simple, that if I say that you mix A and B, two components, at, let us say, a pH, I'm just using some technical term, at a pH of 3 to 5, you get C. And I illustrate that in my patent. Okay? You reproduce that, that is adequate for me to get a patent, if I satisfy all the conditions of patentability. Now you want to set up a plant, right? And I said you mix A with B. So you go and set up a plant with A and B, but I did not tell you what sort of a huge mixer you're going to use, etc., etc., in the industrial scale. That is my know-how. That I keep in my pocket as a trade secret. So I give you the license to use the patent, you use the invention, and then you come to me for the trade secrets, etc. So that's the way we commercialize our technology. So this is a fairly intricate part of it. So we must understand in case of software, in my patent application, I disclose my invention, I give you the best mode of operating that, that's it. That does not mean that you'll be able to reproduce everything about the technology. There's a big gap between the invention and the technology.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
That this session was quite illuminating. Before we break, I'm sure that this was good food for thought in terms of the intangibles, and the tangible food is waiting outside there. Okay, intangible. Thank you very much. I would appreciate that.
I request Professor Yogesh Pai to please.
Oh yeah. Sure.
We break for lunch and we resume by 2:00.